fail to break into Stairway to Heaven just that Sunday. I'm glad you're not doing that, because that feels so good. Our reading today comes from the Unitarian Universalist minister, the Reverend Kendall Gibbons, who's also an atheist, or what we UUs would call humanist. As a young Unitarian Universalist in the 1960s, I was educated about human sexuality in a relatively open fashion. Human religious experience, by contrast, was a closed book. I discovered my spirituality in much the same way that my peers raised in more conservative faiths discovered their sexuality, accidentally, furtively, without guidance, moved by overwhelming inner tides and with some sense of shame. I longed for the white organdy dresses, First Communion dresses. I longed for the menorah candles of my neighbors. I secretly memorized Louisa May Alcott's My Kingdom Prayer, written when she was 13, and sang myself to sleep with For the Beauty of the Earth. I was fascinated by the hidden life of nuns. I yearned for someone, anyone, to take my childish capacity for devotion seriously. But seeds planted in windowsills, in paper cups, on a Sunday school windowsill, the dead bird discovered in the backyard, the calligraphic hymns, and We Sing of Life, the annual flower communion, they were the scant resources that my liberal religious education offered. To my parents and teachers, almost all of whom had grown up in other religious tradition, the absence of texts, the absence of rote prayers and sacraments and holy objects and moralistic picture books represented freedom, but without any language for my emerging sense of mystery and wonder, I came to feel the contrary, deprived of the tools with which to understand and experience. Express those experiences, those desires. I floundered, she says, in a kind of guilty yearning until I became intellectually mature enough to claim the rich heritage of humanity's religious cultures for myself. I did so greedily, with none of the literalism that affects fundamentalists, whether orthodox or humanist. As a student of religion, in college, I read the Christian women mystics, the Zen teachers, the Taoist poets. I studied the art and architecture, music and mysteries of the world's religions, and discovered how each constructed the landscape of spiritual experience. What I sought was some way to bring order to what had always been going on inside of me, and I encountered a whole universe of souls across every culture and tradition who seemed to know all about it. What we feel on the shores of the ocean or the mountain heights is no special insight of our own. It is the common heritage of the human race. There is nothing so petulant as to throw away what our ancestors have tried to pass on to us in the form of stories and symbols and stones, in scriptures and songs, in rituals and prayers, because we think that we, in our adolescent hubris, know better. Who can stand in the shadow of the Great Pyramids or in the radiant light and soaring stone of the Cathedral at Chartres? Who can listen to the deep cadences of the Book of Common Prayer fall sonorous on the ear and not realize in the very fiber of our being that our wonder and that our hunger and our terror and even our most valiant yes to life are not ours alone, but echo down the ages of the whole human race. And here ends the reading.
Thank you.
15 years old, I considered myself the most open-minded person around. Intelligent, well-read, and don't forget, sensitive. I was a figure skater, after all. I am, still. It was not an opinion, however, shared by my high school English teacher, Mrs. Starkey. Mrs. Starkey was short, and she was solid. She had a flip in her hair that kind of went like this. Her dark eyes could bore holes straight through your soul. She saw a young man who was anxiously tied to his conservative Christian faith, and you know, it wasn't as if she was coming from a place of Christian bashing. She was a faithful Methodist, or perhaps a Presbyterian, and I think she still is, and of course, if she ends up reading this sermon, be assured she will correct me in all manners of detail, like she did on my grammar and spelling and essay construction and on and on. Mrs. Starkey believed, like so many of us Unitarian Universalists do, that integrity in religion is not so much a matter of grit your teeth and believe it even if you know it ain't so or you're not really sure, as it is this, a matter of having meaningfully engaged one's beliefs through questions and doubts and sympathetic investigation of alternate points of view and the test of personal experience. Integrity is when your beliefs have substance and staying power, and you know it. You have worked hard to discern that. So Mrs. Starkey decided to give me a special reading assignment, something from the pen of that 20th century existentialist icon, who's also an atheist, Albert Camus. One day, she handed me a book, and she said, "Read." I read the front cover, and the front cover said, "The plague." I read the back cover, and the back cover said something about how the book explored an epidemic that struck the Algerian city of Oran and had devastating consequences, both physical and spiritual. I read this, and I said to myself, uh-oh. 30 years later, I appreciate this as a brilliant move, and sometimes it takes 30 years to appreciate things like this. Fact was, while I was blithely holding on to my Church of Christ faith, that God protects the righteous from harm always, that religious perfectionism pays, at the same time my family was a plague scene in its own way. Mental illness, neglect, drug abuse, violence, misery. Mrs. Starkey had heard the rumors around town about Dr. Makar's family. She'd heard those rumors. And I loved Mrs. Starkey, and I trusted her. She was one of the few adults that I did, that I felt I could go to and share what was going on in my life and get something back that would be helpful to me. So she knew what was going on behind closed doors. So I think that she assigned to me the plague to enable me to begin healing the split between my ideals and between the reality of my days, the split between my thoughts about God and religion and what was going on the ground. So reluctantly, I cracked the book open and I read passages like this. "Do you believe in God? No. But what does that really mean? I'm fumbling in the dark, struggling to make something out, but I have long since I've long ceased finding that original." And then this one. "What does it mean, the plague? It's life. That's all." And then this quote. "It is in the thick of calamity that one gets hardened to the truth. In other words, to the silence." And then this quote. "Thus, each of us had to be content to live only for the day, alone, under the vast indifference of the sky." So let me ask you, have you ever tried a kind of candy called Pop Rocks? Pop Rocks. Maybe it's a generational thing. You know, you Gen X folks out there, you're survivors. You're survivors. It's basically a sugar processed with carbon dioxide. So when you let the rocks melt in your mouth, they crackle, they sizzle, they pop, they explode. You know, don't fill your mouth up with them and then drink Diet Coke. Don't do that. But the thing about that, there's pain and pleasure to that experience, and when that happens, when it's all mixed together, it just is this incredible experience. That's what those words from the plague felt like in my mouth when I said them to myself. The vast indifference of the sky. Pop! I've long ceased finding that original. Pop! Pop, pop, pop! Despite my good Church of Christ training, I could heartily sympathize with this book. Jesus himself on the cross had said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And that's what I was hearing in Albert Camus' book. I was hearing the vast indifference of the sky. I was hearing that. The plague looks upon our world and wants to say there is no God, there is no afterlife, there is nothing to redeem all this, nothing supernatural to redeem all this, which is not to say that there can be no redemption at all. Not to say that, just a different kind of redemption. Listen to more of what this book says. All I maintain is that on this earth there are pestilences and there are victims, and it is up to us as far as possible not to join forces with the pestilences. Or this quote. After a short silence, the doctor raised himself a little in his chair and asked if Taru had an idea of the path to follow for attaining peace. Yes, he replied, the path of sympathy. Or this quote, a loveless world is a dead world. And always there comes an hour when one is weary of prisons, of one's work, and of devotion to duty, and all one craves is a loving face. All one craves is the warmth and wonder of a loving heart. Now let me say as a side note that the knee-jerk discrimination and bigotry that atheists can face is astonishing, especially in America. You don't believe in God, you may disagree with the sheriff of Bay County, and you are instantly branded as wicked and immoral. You'll be considered ineligible for public office. You will be judged a deficient soldier. You will be seen as unsuitable for marriage and child rearing and adoption. Yet just listen to what the plague says. The way to peace is the path of sympathy. It's up to us not to join forces with the pestilences. In the end, what truly matters is love. A loveless world is a dead world. Love is what I longed for back then. Love is what I still long for. And so do we all, caring and kindness and love. Atheism is not the satanic thing that too many people think it is. Atheists acknowledge the vast indifference of the sky, but they are neither paralyzed nor perverted by that. They go on to find ways of making this world a better place. That is the meaning of their lives. They will not join forces with the pestilences. Thanks to Mrs. Starkey, reading the plague started me on the path of healing that split in my life between belief and experience. And in the end, I did not become an absolute atheist in the sense of rejecting all God concepts and all affirmations that there's more to reality than this physical world. But I did become a relative atheist. A relative atheist. I eventually realized that my Church of Christ God was a fake, phony, made no sense in light of all the plagues in my world and the larger world. Today, if you tell me about the God you don't believe in, the God you don't believe in, I will probably say that I don't believe in that kind of God either. I got so much from the plague. A lot from the plague. But the one thing I did not get, which is what I want to focus on right now, was atheism's approach to the stuff of religion. the stuff of religion beyond the God doctrines. I'm talking about the worship services, the music, the buildings, the prayers, the rituals, the feasts, the shrines, the pilgrimages, the communal meals, the art, and on and on and on. Atheism denies the existence of anything supernatural or otherworldly, but what is its stance on the spiritual tools and practices that the historical religions have passed down through the ages, generation after generation? Are good atheists supposed to reject all that stuff too? America, you know Steve Martin. Steve Martin likes to say that atheists don't have no songs. Have you seen that performance? Is that true? Is it true that atheists don't have no songs? Good grammar. It's good grammar. It's an important question for us as Unitarian Universalists because lots of us are atheists, or to use our more common language, a humanist. And today's reading illustrates how it can be that in UU circles, the value of the material of the world's religious traditions, or the possibility of their being used in ways that are broader and more inclusive, has been questioned, is in doubt. To my parents and teachers, says the Reverend Kendall Gibbons, the absence of texts and rote prayers and sacraments and holy objects and moralistic picture books represented freedom. But, she goes on to say, without any language for my emerging sense of mystery and wonder, I came to feel the contrary, not freedom, deprived of the tools, deprived of the tools with which to understand or express those experiences. Whether atheists don't have no songs or whether they do, it is important. It's also important for the millions and millions of atheists beyond these walls. Religion writer Stephen Prothero, who's a pretty sharp guy, he describes the currently very influential new atheism of people like Richard Dawkins and Daniel Dennett and Sam Harris and Christopher Hitchens as basically saying this. Here's the basic through line. Religious people are stupid. We are religious people, by the way. Religious people are stupid, and religion is poison. So the only way forward is to educate the idiots and flush away the poison. That's the only way forward. But when we flush away everything that religion brings to the table, everything that it brings to the table, which is far more than God doctrines, which also includes the rituals and the practices and the community gatherings and the holidays and the art and on, where does that leave us? Well, what it does, it leaves us with secular educational institutions, which for the most part focus on teaching job skills, but step back from teaching people how to live soulfully and well. For the most part, it leaves us with a secular calendar, stripped of Hanukkah and Christmas, which is the Unitarian holiday, Christmas and Ramadan and Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur and Passover and Easter and all the other religious holidays and holy days and festivals that bring us back to key images and ideas that keep us human and vital in our relationships and our world. It leaves us with secular museums, which often feature self-referential art pieces that are curious and fascinating, but don't necessarily help us to deepen our sense of the joy and terror of being human. Don't help us cope. They don't help us grow. It leaves us with a secular city that is fragmented and has few gathering places where poets and philosophers and non-traditional spiritual folk and artists and activists and others of similar ilk, you know who you are, few places where people like us can gather, can be strong together, can challenge a world that's not working in the ways it's not working, help create a better future. To jettison religious leaves us with a secular economy that tells us that the person with the most toys wins and equates value and self-value with things. Flush away everything that comes with the historical religions, and what is left is grim. Not so much in the culture is left to help us do what Albert Camus said and resist joining forces with the pestilences. But Swiss philosopher Alain de Botton says that we don't have to accept this forced choice option, this either-or option. Either we swallow religious doctrines we absolutely don't believe in, or we reject everything that religion stands for as poison. There is a third way, says Alain de Botton, a third way. He calls it atheism 2.0. That's what he calls it. It's for the person who thinks this. The person who thinks, I can't believe all that stuff about God. I can't believe all that stuff about supernatural spirits and angels and on and on. And I can't believe that stuff. But you know what? I like Christmas carols. I really like the art of Mantegna. I like that music that he was playing. That's religious music. I really like looking at old churches. I really like turning the pages of the Old Testament. Atheism 2.0 is about taking the best out of the world's religions and leaving the useless stuff behind. The secular world, says Alain de Botton, is full of holes. And a thorough study of religion could give us all sorts of insights into areas of life that are just not going too well. We have, he says, invented religions to serve two central needs. And these needs continue to this day. And secular society is not doing a very good job in meeting these needs. And here are those needs. First of all, the need to live together in communities of harmony despite our deeply rooted, selfish, and violent impulses. And then second, our need to cope with terrifying degrees of pain which arise from our vulnerability to professional failure, to troubled relationships, to the death of loved ones, to our own decay, our own demise. God may be dead, says Alain de Botton, but the urgent issues which impel us to make him up still stir within us. They still stir within us. They still demand resolutions which do not go away when we have been nudged to perceive some scientific inaccuracies in the tale of the seven loaves and fishes. They don't go away. Doesn't matter what the fundamentalists say, that's stupid. The needs don't go away in us. They don't go away. This last quote, not the stupid part. I made that one. This last quote, it comes from his book, Religion for Atheists, A Non-Believer's Guide to the Uses of Religion. A wonderfully dangerous and subversive book, says the San Francisco Chronicle. Quirky, often hilarious, says the Washington Post. Sophisticated and perceptive, one of the very best books I've ever read to help me to see the depths and complexities of religion. And in particular, I'm pleased that it's taken an atheist to help me, someone who believes that God is not dead, to deepen my appreciation for what I love and for what I do. As a job, guess who came up with that quote? It's from the Anthony Makar Gazette, Beacon, Herald, Trumpet, Bugle, Journal, Constitution. It takes a little bit for that joke to kind of get in. That's good. I like that. It's great. Let's talk back in the middle of the sermon. It's just a great book. So the Miss Starkey and me wants to assign you this book. This is the book that the Miss Starkey and me wants to assign to you. Here's a taste of his perceptiveness. And I'm quoting from a TED talk that he gave on Atheism 2.0. Just listen. He says another point on education. We tend to believe in the modern secular world that if you tell someone something once, they will remember it. Sit them down in a classroom, tell them about Plato at the age of 20, and send them out for a career in management consultancy for 40 years, and that lesson is going to stick with them. We do that anyhow, right? Don't we? I was a college professor. I did that all the time. But he goes on to say, religions go nonsense. You need to keep repeating the lesson 10 times a day. So get on your knees and repeat it. That's what religions tell us. Get on your knees and repeat it 10 or 20 or 50 times a day. Otherwise, our minds forget. Our minds are like sieves. That's just how they work. Religions, he says, are cultures of repetition. They circle the great truths again and again and again. We associate repetition with boredom. Give us the new, we say in secular culture. The new is better than the old. If I say to you, he says, okay, we're not going to have any new TEDs. We're just going to run through all the old ones. And we're going to watch them 5 times because they're so true. We're going to watch that Elizabeth Gilbert one 5 times because what she says is so clever. Well, in secular world, and you know, secular logic would say that's terrible. This is boring. You feel cheated. Not so if you are adopting a religious mentality, a religious mindset. The other thing he says that religion do is arrange time. All the major religions give us calendars. What is a calendar? A calendar is a way of making sure that across the year you will bump into certain very important ideas. That's good. That's the sound of a growing church right there. That's the sound of a growing church. So back to him. In the Catholic chronology, Catholic calendar, at the end of March, you will think about St. Jerome and all his qualities of humility and goodness and generosity to the poor. You won't do that by accident. You will do that because you are guided to do that. Now, we don't think that way, he says. In the secular world, we think, if an idea is important, I'll bump into it. I'll just come across it. And he says, nonsense. Nonsense, says the religious worldview. The religious view says that we need calendars. We need to structure time. We need to synchronize encounters. This comes across also in the way religions set up rituals around important feelings like joys and concerns. I added that part. All of that's Alain de Botton. He's like so good. Just a small sampling of how religion, far from being stupid and poisonous, has actually a great deal to teach even those who cannot stomach the theological God doctrines, even those folks. Atheism 2.0. It says that, absolutely, atheists don't have no songs. That's what it says. They have songs, and the songs are ancient. They are tried and true. Come on, guys.
Sorry.
That's fine. It's good. Yeah. It's scary.
This is his first
thing. Maybe he's a budding atheist. maybe this is going to stay with him. So, yeah, it's not true. Atheists do have songs. Songs that are tried and true. They come to us from the world's great religions. They can still speak to us today. To think, says the Reverend Kendall Gibbons, that we must dispense with all the traditional language and symbols and concepts in order to speak about that which is deepest and truest and dearest is to assume that no human beings were ever before so clever or so profound or so committed as we are. That those who have been down the path of life before us have no wisdom to teach us now, that we can learn nothing from all that they have left to us. That is why we gather every Sunday. That is why we worship together every Sunday. That is why we sing hymns. That is why we pray. That is why we meditate. That is why we have sermons. It's why we do what we do. Of course, we are a diverse community embracing people who come down on all sides of the God issue. So our goal in worship and in singing and praying and meditating and everything else is to do all of this in ways that are as open and as inclusive as possible for atheists and for all and the rest of the world. I can hear the rest of the world is saying, are you crazy? That's what the world is saying. And maybe we are crazy. But one thing I know for sure is that we are passionately caught up in a vision. We are passionately caught up in a vision that all people want to live more richly. All people want to forgive more deeply. All people want to find more meaning. All people want to love more fully. All people, not just some. Let's not divide up our families and our world on the basis of God beliefs. We just don't have to think alike to worship alike, or to hymn sing alike, or to pray alike, or to meditate alike. We just don't. God ideas may come, God ideas may go, but religion, our need for it, its forms and its fashions, its communities and its festivals and its pilgrimages and its calendars and on, that remains. It is an eternal verity. An eternal verity. So I want a religious filled with emotion, even if you value critical thinking and the scientific method, even if you don't believe in God, amen. Let me have an amen.
Amen.
Let's sing our hymn now. Number 295.